And go. Welcome to the Contemporary Issues class. Thanks everyone for coming. September 15. We're already in mid-September. The year is just rolling along quickly. And today we are going to be talking about the U.S. Supreme Court and its recent decisions that are controversial and kind of the court's turn to the right. So we're going to have a good presentation review of some of the key cases by Ron Puning, and also with the help of our two attorney classmates, Jeff Klaus and Linda Daniel. So we are glad to have them. They've already had a little meeting here and talked about their impressions of these cases. And I'm going to ask them also, why have these justices made these decisions in these cases? What is the reasoning behind it? Is it a political ideological desire to go a certain direction, or is it more a constitutional objective reading of these cases? Or common sense. I think it's helpful for us to kind of understand what's going on after 70 some years of Roe v. Wade and other liberal decisions. There seems to be a change. So we're going to talk about why is that, and why does it affect issues of faith and justice. So we'll have good stuff. But first, we want to welcome our Zoomers. Nice to have you all here, folks from out of the country and out of the state. And please mute yourself in the lower left corner of your screen. We are recording this for future playback. And since we are talking political issues again today, please be kind in your comments and fair to both sides, because as you know, we have folks on both sides of the political spectrum here and all points in between. So any other announcements, things in the news we want to speak about? We were just talking up here a moment ago about the cats and dogs issue this week from Ohio. And there was a very good story in the Washington Post yesterday that traced this back, where it started and where it came from. And the short version is, the Post found that it started by one post on Facebook. Wow. It was then reposted many times, never confirmed, and then picked up by the Republican Party administrative people, and said this is an issue we can use to our advantage. And so it went from there, and then ended up in the presidential debate, and that it is regarding this small town in Ohio that had Springfield, that had 20,000 Haitian immigrants brought in legally by a government program from these folks who had were fleeing violence in Haiti. And they collected in this town and took jobs that were new jobs, and they did an excellent work for those employers. And so the town had been pretty happy with the situation until there was conflict between the longtime residents and the new folks. And so that started up this backlash and Facebook comments, and then erupted into now part of the national immigration debate. But it's been also
national news last night.
National news, yes. So
she recanted the story.
The lady, the person who put the original
post. It wasn't a Russian troll. It wasn't a Russian troll.
This shows the dangers of the time we live in, how things can blow up from one unsubstantiated allegation into something. Anyway, bring out the.
Pardon me. Say it in the beginning.
I don't think that was reported. Just maybe she didn't like some of the Haitian immigrants there and wanted to say something negative and spread gossip.
Or maybe they did. Maybe one.
Maybe one, or she thought they actually did, or something, or a duck, or a goose, or something. Ooh. But we live and learn. Okay, with that, I'm going to hit share screen so we can begin our presentation and share it with our Zoomers. Can you see that okay, Susan and Grant? Okay. Ron, thank you for presenting this. And Jeff and Linda, tell us what's going on with this issue.
Okay. Well, first of all, the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court is John Roberts. This is not the Diana Ross Supreme Court, for those that remember music. And I thought we'd play a segment of a song that I call the Supreme Court song. In 1954, there was the Kansas Board of Education decision that was a critical one. And this song was written right at that time, but it wasn't recorded and put out in the public until Three Dog Night did it, roughly 1966. We're going to hear just a small segment of that song. Anybody remember that? Okay. All righty, let's get going. There's a picture of our current Supreme Court, John Roberts, and the current composition, which finally 30 years ago, you would not see any virtually no until Sandra Day O'Connor showed up. You would not have seen any women or people of color until a few decades ago. Now we're starting to get at least some mix of representation on the court. Next slide. A couple of the most famous but more infamous decisions in the Supreme Court, the 1957 Roger Taney Court, that's Roger himself, made the Dred Scott decision. The court decided that all people of African ancestries, slaves as well as those who were free, could never become citizens of the United States. Interesting, not only did it say slaves couldn't ever be citizens, but any free Black could never be a citizen. And if the more you read of that decision, the more repulsive it is. Next one. So that was one of the worst of all time. Plessy versus Ferguson, 1896, upheld the constitutionality of racial segregation laws. I believe that's a picture of Mr. Plessy. And he was, an octoroon. He had about one-eighth, no more than one-quarter, Black in his ancestry. But he was pushed to the back of the train, whatever, in the South. Next one. And then, of course, the decision that this Three Dog Night song came out with, the Brown versus the Board of Education. And three of the more prominent people in this decision were, of course, Chief Justice Earl Warren, and then lawyer Thurgood Marshall, and Charles Houston. Those were two lawyers for the NAACP. There's a fantastic movie called Separate But Equal with Sidney Poitier. It's a good 3.5 hours long, but it is gripping. It's one of the best movies I have ever seen. So if you get a chance to review it, on a good Saturday evening or something. I highly recommend Separate But Equal by Sidney Poitier and Burt Lancaster as key actors. Next slide. Okay, we're going to get right into some of the most recent decisions, in the at least things that have come out in the last couple of years. For those of us who love books, the books are having a hard time keeping up because the decisions are coming in so fast and they're so significant that it's hard for the publishing industry to keep up with what's happening. Again, I want to thank Linda and Jeff. We had a pre-session where particularly our lawyer wizards here helped us pick out some of the key and salient issues. Also, a handout. This just arrived in my mailbox yesterday. I subscribed to Scientific American. I first got a subscription to it when I was a junior in high school. And it made a contribution to my going into engineering and I guess reflected my interest in science. But Scientific American usually does not go into politics. You won't find political articles in there. Until about a year and a half ago, they finally decided some of the political decisions and things were so anti-science and so egregious to scientific thinking, they had to speak up. So they did take a position on the presidential election in 2020. And this editorial just showed up in Scientific American that hit my mailbox yesterday. And the board of directors have some very powerful things to say about how the Supreme Court is kicking science in the butt, put it bluntly.
Can I read this one part just real quick?
Yeah.
This article points out that there was a grave science error in the Justice Neil Gorsuch's opinion in a case. He confused nitrous oxide, a pollutant, with nitrogen oxide, known as laughing gas. So there was an actual, the other way around. Yeah, I read it. Yeah, so it confused two separate elements and got it completely wrong in the Supreme Court decision. And so the Science Magazine is pointing that out.
So if they can't get such details straight, how can they rule on something?
That's one of those.
Okay. Alrighty.
They're humans.
Yeah.
Okay, we're going to get right into a couple of biggies. We're going to start with two cases that have been decided in the 2023-2024 session that strongly curtailed the power of federal agencies. We say federal agencies, we particularly think of the Environmental Protection Agency, Food and Drug Administration. There's a lot of other powerful and much needed federal agencies. But there was a decision that just came out June of 2024 called the Chevron overturn. There was also one in the same month, just a few months ago, pared back the power of the Securities and Exchange Commission, holding that the SEC, Securities and Exchange Commission, cannot continue to use in-house proceedings to impose fines in securities fraud cases. So they stripped away the ability of the SEC to impose fines, making it easier for people to dodge fines and actions from the SEC. Next slide. Let's get right into the Chevron. I think this one digs into it. Okay, the Chevron ruling, June 28th, 2024, that's very recent, sharply reduced the ability of federal agencies, NASA, EPA, others, to interpret the laws they administer, ruling that the courts should generate the opinion. Trying to put it in simple terms, Congress will often pass a bill saying, you will put in some clean air or clean water actions, and we need a rule against atmospheric emission pollution and things. And the EPA is given the authority to put it into finer detail, you know, what pollutants to what milligrams per cubic centimeter, that kind of thing. to flesh in the detail, the fine detail. Just like a law enforcement agency has some, the police department has some flexibility. They have to enforce certain laws a certain way, but the exact implementation methods, the police departments have at least some freedom to do that. But this law basically said, no, 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 we don't want federal agencies to flesh out in detail the rules and make any interpretation of it. That's got to happen back in the courts. And the effect of this,
Congress.
Yeah, yeah. The effect of this is that it very much cripples the ability of organizations like the EPA to impose laws.
Just did some studying on this. And one of the things that's so interesting that is so negative about this decision is the fact that the agency, like the EPA, take them for instance, the SEC, they have in on their staff, they have people with incredible knowledge about the issue at stake, because that's their job. But then you throw it back to Congress. They're not schooled in all of this. It's the same thing as this opinion right here where he mixes up the gases. They're just not schooled in this, but someone who is working, let's say, for the EPA would obviously not make that mistake.
Yeah.
So it really makes your regulations that are the fine print of a law, the regulations that govern it, not as effective, not at all as effective.
You can certainly see this also comes into play with the Food and Drug Administration and approving new drugs. Who do you want to decide on new drugs and their test and formulation? Do you want scientists and doctors making those decisions? Or do you want Lauren Boebert? Yeah, okay. Linda.
I think she said it quite well that it will affect every single agency who go through the hearing process with experts making the decisions instead of judges who don't have that expertise.
Why did the justices decide that way? Why wouldn't they want the experts at the regulatory level to make those decisions? What was the reasoning?
Well, there's a couple of things going on. I think they kind of merge politics and legal thinking together. You know, you have a group of Supreme Court justices now that are very enamored with this idea of original interpretation of the Constitution. So if it's not in the Constitution, it doesn't exist or it doesn't count. And of course, then I think they mash that up with sort of some of their political leanings that have an outcome that maybe they like or that maybe they also promote. But in the Chevron thing, for example, I think rightly back in 1984, the court said, we've got these wonderful agencies with experts and they're given power by Congress to promulgate regulations and rules to enforce these statutes that are more broadly written and don't have that detail. And then the agencies can develop the regulations that make sense and that are science-based and policy-driven under the goals of the and aspirations of the legislation to begin with. But the court, under this originalist thinking, thinks that's an abdication of Congress's power to make law, and that Congress does not have the power to give away its power to make law to unelected agencies. And so these unelected agencies, no matter how smart they are, they don't have the constitutional authority to make law. And so they're repealing that power. What the Chevron decision doctrine did was, and that's what I learned in law school, because that's right when I was in law school, and it was already the law and the practice before that case affirmed it, but was when an agency developed a regulation or an interpretation, the courts were supposed to give it deference, and they were supposed to say, oh yeah, you're the agency, we're going to defer to you on close calls or on how to interpret that. Okay. Got that right so far?
Yep.
And that would carry the day when there was any challenges to the rules. With this new case, the Ohio versus EPA, the court is saying that we no longer have to give deference to these agencies. We can re-examine them kind of from scratch or de novo and look at this stuff without giving that deference that they did before, which puts them then in the position of being legislators themselves, the court, or in leaving questions unanswerable that the Congress could never really adequately answer in the first place or second place or third place. That's enough, I guess.
Jane?
Well, I was just going to say that as far as the EPA is concerned, I would say that underneath all of that, and perhaps instigating, driving it, are big business, because they do not like the Environmental Protection Agency to deal with a lot of things that cause them to deal with that they have to do in order to produce their manufactured goods or whatever it is that they're dealing with. Because that's been something we've been hearing about for some time.
Yeah.
That they didn't particularly like that.
Yeah, so maybe this was a...
Yeah, I think that's true of the FDA.
Yeah.
Big Pharma doesn't want them standing in the way, or the FAA. Say Boeing, you can't.
Reaction to a conservative view that regulatory agencies have gone overboard with too much regulation of business and environmental.
For our protection, which it is.
And that's where it sort of all mashes together with this originist legal doctrine, right leaning. Maybe the super capitalism type view.
I think we had an example this week with the closure of the Boar's Head plant in Virginia. You read about that?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Okay, the liverwurst and the salmonella? Listeria.
Yeah.
So again, there's big business isn't fond of regulations and isn't fond of... particularly environmental, health and safety. Yeah, it's an impediment to making all the money you can. Get all you can and can all you get. Okay. Yeah, that's the third thing there, that very bottom bullet, number three, tosses the decision into a wide range of courts scattered across the country, almost always with inferior technical expertise. And of course, when you toss it into the courts, delay. You know, our courts are snail paced at best, and this makes them even slower.
And the courts are really reliant on the litigants to advise them of these science questions and the amicus curiae brief and the two opposing sides. I mean, I don't know if it's changed, but when I went to law school, we did not have a single science class.
Okay.
So, what if there's a ruling made and they go back and find it has done a lot of damage?
Yeah.
Is there any way to correct it?
Take it back through the courts, but you may come down with the same decision and. The harm is done.
Okay.
But some eventually are overturned, like slavery and after a long time.
Okay. There's a quick West Virginia versus the APA. The EPA's authority to regulate emissions of greenhouse gases for existing power plants has been drastically hurt by recent decisions. Next slide. Official acts. We won't dwell on this too much. The court, of course, put out a decision saying that the Supreme Court, that presidents enjoy immunity from their official acts. And a lot of people are very angered by this. Others are liberated by this. our lawyer team here.
I have a quote from the dissent on this case. Justice Sotomayor said, and I'm quoting, "Today's decision to grant former presidents criminal immunity reshapes the institution of the presidency. It makes a mockery of the principle foundational to our Constitution and system of government that no man is above the law. The majority today, so the six justices, endorses an expansive vision of presidential immunity that was never recognized by the founders. Any sitting president, the executive branch, or even President Trump's lawyers until now. Settled understandings of the Constitution are of little use to the majority in this case, and so it ignores them." So the courts have always looked at what's called precedent, decisions that were made before, and most courts will also, other than the current court, take into fact the societal changes and what has come about since the founding fathers. So this is a pretty important case, and we'll see what happens down the road as a result of it.
Okay, next slide. Third Trump case. This by 6-3 decision, this was Fisher versus the U.S. The justices narrowed the scope of the federal criminal statute under which hundreds of the January 6th defendants were charged. I think the original law said it's a crime to obstruct, influence, or impede any official proceeding. But Roberts narrowed it to say the prosecutors must show that an offendant tampered or attempted to tamper with the physical evidence of the proceeding. Wow.
Yeah, just kind of, a lot of people are scratching their heads about that one.
Yeah.
To how they pulled that out as a limitation on the much broader language actually in the otherwise obstruct, influence, or impede language, which pretty broad. And now it only has to do with physical evidence. I think when we were talking about it in the session before, we came up with the example, arguably you could go hold a gun to the legislature's head. And as long as you didn't impede with their paperwork or the computer records that they had, that was not a violation of that statute. It might be a violation of something else, but...
Did the court not give any indication of why they pulled out this physical evidence part? No reasoning that we know of. I haven't heard of
it. You know, I haven't read that opinion.
Yeah. So.
And it's really hard to analyze, even just with newspaper articles and news reports about what these are, unless you actually read them, the decisions yourself, and have some understanding of the precedent before that. Constitutional law is a kind of a specialty that there's not many lawyers that are real, real experts at. Even the ones on TV say they are. I had a constitutional law professor, and we talked about all the issues of the day, 40 years ago. But and it takes that kind of really understanding to really kind of parse it out. I mean, I've followed the Roe v. Wade decisions pretty carefully and read that number of times, and then have read the cases that upheld it, and then read in detail the first Dobbs decision that was leaked, and then the final one. So I had a pretty good understanding of that decision, but this one,
okay,
I'm not really sure.
Okay, we'll move on. Let's hit the next one. Okay, and then of course the Roe versus Wade overturn, otherwise known as Dobbs versus Jackson. And of course, this has maybe been the number one thing across the nation in the last year. So that one is still reverberating and will for probably many, many a year. Okay, next one.
Before we leave that important one, can I ask our attorneys, why did the court, what's the simple explanation of why the court did that?
The court found in that one, the simple answer, in my opinion, is that they did not like the reasoning of Roe v. Wade in finding the scope of the right of privacy to include rights of abortion, which is kind of interesting because the right of privacy that was reiterated in Roe, and you help me out if I get anything wrong on this, is also the underpinning of a lot of other statute or cases that have overruled as unconstitutional decisions about interracial marriage and that kind of thing. That right of privacy has a bit of history that goes beyond and before Roe v. Wade.
But well, I think it also addressed the right of each individual's privacy to have their own conversation with their doctors, interfered with that right and the right to govern what I do with my body. And I think that is the bigger thing, but it came up, you know, people have been working to get rid of abortion for
The Constitution long time. Doesn't say there's a right of privacy. And so even though I think the Supreme Court has acknowledged, and I think the founding fathers thought there were implied rights in the Constitution, you know, it's up to the courts to decide what those implied rights are.
But there are a lot of rights that we consider our rights that may be challenged.
Yeah.
Like you said, the right to interracial marriage, same-sex marriage, and on, the rights that we consider under our government to be our independent rights.
So there's some cherry picking too. For one thing, in Dobbs' case, Alito relied on this doctrine of historical precedent for things. And he focused on everything before Roe v. Wade was initially decided and kind of ignored everything that however many years it's been since Roe v. Wade as being part of that history, which we now have. So I think that was sort of a cherry picking thing on his behalf.
Well, some of the critics of the Dobbs decision are saying that the rationale, there's a lot of faulty rationale in that decision.
Yeah, and that's just one of them.
Yeah.
Would it be fair to say, I'll try to stop dominating, would it be fair to say that the conservative justices look at the Constitution and say that there's nothing in there specifically saying there's a right to an abortion, so this should be just a state issue?
Yeah, that's simple.
Is that a way to, versus liberal justices who would say it's implied that we have these rights, even though it's not specifically said, it's clearly implied under a right to privacy and things. And so it's logical for us to give these rights to people.
Yes.
Is that kind of what has developed?
Plus the precedent for 50 years of working under the Roe v. Wade decision. It should have had some impact.
In a way, this is a lot like the Chevron case, because it's the way courts look at state laws. And if a state passes a law that clearly violates a constitutional right that's protected, like let's say the First Amendment right to free speech, which is always protected, or the Second Amendment right seems to be always protected, because those are clear rights in the Constitution. And so any statute by a state that impedes that federally constitutionally protected right is subject to what they call strict scrutiny. You've got to really prove as a state that you're not unfairly and unreasonably impeding that right, and that it has a compelling and overwhelming reason that you have to do it. And what Dobbs is basically saying now is that the courts can't strictly construe or strictly scrutinize state laws regarding abortion.
So how does that affect Colorado's laws? I mean, I thought we were, quote, safe, but it's sounding like maybe not.
Well, yeah, it goes both ways. The door swings both ways. So if you want to enact laws that are liberally allow abortion, the court can't second guess those either on constitutional basis.
Right.
Unless your state constitution has something in it that protects that right, which would then give it all the weight it needed.
Which is why 18, 20 states now are passing more restrictive laws, and probably an equal number, including Colorado, are saying abortion is a right in this state. So it's a division in the country.
So it's kind of be careful what you wish for, I guess. Yeah.
May I ask a question?
Sure, go ahead, Grant.
What part of the Constitution played in reversing things back to the states? Was it the 10th Amendment?
I was going to bring my copy of the Constitution.
The 10th Amendment, my understanding of the 10th Amendment is that anything not covered in the Constitution refers back to the states. So education is not listed in the Constitution, neither is abortion. Is that maybe the basis for what happened? How it was reversed to the states?
Neither is gay marriage mentioned.
No, that comes much into play in that whole thing, because they're saying there's no federally protected right. So therefore it's not subject to strict scrutiny, and the states have more leeway in how they can regulate that. And same with education. But then there's other parts in Article 2 of the Constitution that talk about, and I'm drawing a blank there because I'm not like Justice Black, who always carried the Constitution with me, never quoted off the cuff. He said, well, when people ask him what the Constitution says, he'd pull out his copy and read it. What are the other visions for the common good, or the Congress has these phrases that we all necessary and means for doing this and that for the, and those are the provisions that grant Congress, the U.S. Congress, the authority to do what it does. No one has a copy of the Constitution. Yeah, it's on our phone. We all have it here.
Okay, yeah, let's move on. A couple quick Second Amendment. New York State Rifle Association versus Bruin. Public gun possession is protected right. This is what the Supreme Court came out with. People don't have to show a special need for self-protection to carry concealed handguns in public. And the people can't consider contemporary public safety issues and regulating guns. Ooh, that's a powerful second sentence there. Like, you forget public safety. You can't consider that. And then in U.S. versus Rahami, upheld the law that, this was one where the court, I think, decided the right way. They upheld the law that bars anyone subject to domestic violence restraining order from possessing a gun. So at least they decided, states that have rules saying if you're under a restraining order, you can't have a gun. They at least did that one.
Interesting.
That cartoon. Hey, do you mind stopping that noise? We're considering a bill to overturn gun bans in here. Okay, next one. Okay, there's that violence restraining order. They at least made the right decision on that one. Next, church and state separation. I like that little cartoon. We'll get you to your math lesson in a minute. First, let me tell you about Jesus. This is public funds. They ruled in late 2022, Maine must allow students to use vouchers, education vouchers, at private and religious schools. Okay. So definitely the court is showing an affinity for more religious movement and less separation of church and state. There's a good book that's out recently by Elizabeth Newman, Kingdom of Rage, The Rise of Christian Extremism, and whatever. Next slide. Clean air. Supreme Court blocked the EPA's good neighbor air pollution rule. This came out on June 27th of this year. Blocked a rule issued by the EPA to reduce air pollution from power plants and other industrial facilities. It passed by a vote of only 5-4. I think the new the justice, what's her name, Carrie Barrett? Amy Barrett, sided with the more liberal judges on this one. Okay, next one. 2023 decision against clean water. They made a rule that there's rules on clean water saying the waterways cannot be polluted severely. But some people have made a strict interpretation saying, well, some of these rivers, like the Platte, it doesn't dry up completely, but there are several streams, particularly in New Mexico, Arizona, Colorado, that literally dry up during the summer. And so some of the pollution favoring people say, hey, that's not a river. I don't have to worry about dumping stuff in it.
So but it's more than 100 miles long, and that's what the description of a river is, the length, not...
Yeah, but that's not what the court decided.
Oh, really?
They rolled back. They stripped a lot of wetlands of protection because they're not wet all the time. Okay, next one. The Voting Rights Act, that has been neutered down dramatically. And we touched on that in prior lessons. I won't go into it more today, other than to say the Voting Rights Act, which was first enacted in 65, it was reaffirmed or approved in 70, 75, 82, 92, and 2006. But it was struck down in 2013. And within hours of that strike down, a whole bunch of states came in with rules to put in far more strict voter registration laws. Next one. Student loan forgiveness was struck down. The summer of 2023, Biden versus Nebraska, the court struck down the administration's student loan forgiveness program. The second case, Department of Education versus Brown, the court ruled that individual borrowers who challenged the plan lacked standing to bring the case. So the court is knocking down student loan forgiveness and the ability of a president to do much in the way of student loans. Next one. All right, we're now going to delve a little bit into ethics. How much justice can you afford? This is the, I don't know if you can read this very well, but this is the number of gifts and the dollar amount of gifts that have been given to the various Supreme Court members. And who's the winner? Thomas, $2.4 million. He's got more gifts in number and amount than all the rest of them have combined. In fact, once you get below Alito, the amounts are pretty small, certainly for a period of multi-years. Sotomayor's got just under $16,000. Amy's got only $500. But there's no question who's cashing out.
Better friends.
Yeah. Next one.
I love it.
Okay. Clarence Thomas accepted millions of dollars worth of gifts. Millions of dollars. A total nearly 10 times the value of all the gifts by all the other justices during the same period. 103 gifts valuing more than $2.4 million. Show me a judge in Colorado that's collected anything like this, or any federal level judge that's collected this kind of bucks. It speaks for itself. Alito accepted 16 gifts worth $170,000. That's not trivial. That would make an impact on my budget. Next. Okay. Supreme Court surprise. The court recently wrote some rules around ethics, but there's no enforcement. And the lower courts and other lawyers do have enforceable ethics codes. Imagine if in Arapahoe County or Douglas County court, if the judge was taking on gifts of, you know, $250,000 from the police association or the trial lawyers association, you get pretty angry and say, this is really corrupting the system.
Ron?
Yeah.
Most of the jurors are attorneys by training, am I correct? Attorneys are bound to a code of ethics. When you become a Supreme Court jurist, is that no longer revoked? Is that no longer?
Well, they're not practicing law as regulated by some state. You know, all attorneys are licensed through a state bar.
Right.
And so I think as a federal judge, you're not considered practicing law anymore.
Well, and state attorneys have a code of ethics which can be enforced by the bar or by the courts. And the Supreme Court is self-governing.
Right.
So any ethics rules or enforcement has to come from within that court. And they're not enforceable. There's nobody to enforce any code of, they could make this marvelous code of ethics and never enforce it.
Yeah.
And it is up to the individual justices. For example, Thomas has accepted a lot of money from people whose cases that he then ruled upon.
No.
Yeah. And he should have refused himself, taken himself back and not ruled on that case. He's also ruled on cases that his wife has an effect on. So self-governing, nobody above them to enforce.
Right, because it would be there'd be no consequence of a state court disbarring them or taking their license away as an attorney.
Can a Supreme Court justice be impeached by Congress?
Could be.
Or
yes. Yeah, that would be the only mechanism.
It happened once.
Like you said.
Right. Years.
Years ago.
So the Supreme Court is basically above the law.
Yes.
They are there.
Why?
They are there.
You know, why didn't our government put some restraints on?
Well, I think there's a couple of arguments. One you hear the most is that having any other group being able to subject them to that kind of regulation would impair their independence. And then they would not be an independent judiciary able to rule on acts of Congress and acts of the president. And so they have to have a certain amount of independence, just like the Fed right now. You know, we really like the way that the US Federal Bank is set up because the Fed is independent. And other than being appointed, they really can't be told what to do, you know, and they rely on their expertise. And it's the same thing with the Supreme Court. And that's the number one argument against some kind of outside overseer or above them regulator.
What about impeachment?
Well, you can do that.
But it takes years.
It takes years. And when it
makes, take a Congress that could actually
act. It takes a political will. I think that's part of the reason we've gotten ourselves into the situation we have now is that our Congress, this is just my opinion, that the U.S. Congress has become so ineffective over the last decades that we put bigger burdens on the courts to resolve issues that should be resolved through legislative acts.
Yes.
And so the courts know how to decide cases, and that's what they do. And so more and more of these political cases are being given to them, so they decide them one way or the other, for good, bad, or ugly.
Although they could be removed by impeachment, they serve, I guess the term is, under good behavior.
Yeah.
But they are the ones who decide what good behavior is.
Well, there should be some self-evident. But I think the Thomas case is pretty self-evident.
Crimes, so you, like tax evasion or even petty crimes, do they just get away with it?
They'd have to be impeached. And I think that's kind of going back to the presidential pardon thing. I bet you in that decision, there's stuff that the remedy for removal of a president is impeaching them and going all the way through that process, which is the constitutionally approved method. And nothing else has ever been done. So.
We've got about 9 minutes left.
Yeah. In essence, most of the best people are saying we need to reform the Supreme Court, restore balance, reduce politicization by establishing term limits and steady turnover, where each administration needs to appoint maybe one or two, keep it turning over, require and enforce ethics, and increase access to justice in the lower courts. So next.
And one point on that, I won't take much time. I know you got more, but I think when you hear in the news now stuff about judicial reform of the Supreme Court, you shouldn't fall into play that this is some sort of extremist thing. It's probably some good ideas. Most state Supreme Courts have some kind of term limits or mandatory retirement. And if you do something like that, you can build into it what they call regularity of nominations, where we're having every president gets to nominate somebody. And if you spread that out over time, it in theory should reflect what people are electing. You know, the president, like Obama got one appointment out of 8 years, Trump got three in 4 years. And so that sort of skews the thing a little bit. In theory, you could argue that.
Okay. All right.
Ron says we're going to discussion.
Yep. All right, folks. What's impacting you the most? And I'm nervous about, you know, we do need to make progress trying to reduce global warming and protecting the environment. The problems are not going to go away by themselves. And it just seems like we've got a lot of people that are just digging their heels in on the status quo and do not want to change or make even minor adjustments. It looks like the history of mankind is if money comes up against other interests like environment or rights or stuff, money usually wins.
We're going to have to realize that most of these things are not going to get solved in our lifetime. And it's going to be a long, drawn-out process. Just like what you were saying with the suffragists, it was a 100-year process for women to get the vote. But we have to start somewhere.
And they didn't give up.
They didn't give up, so I guess that's
1970.
Where we are. I don't like
Ron, does anybody need to sign this?
The attendance sheet? Anybody need the attendance sheet? Okay.
Yes. Frank, did you have your hand up?
I didn't get it, so I'll get it later.
Where does the desire to have states decide their own laws fit in today? Ask our lawyers or anybody else. You know, some people feel federal government's gone too far. Each region of the country, the South, you know, they have their own culture, so they should be able to govern themselves. And if you don't like it there, you can move north. Is that a fair assumption?
Well, I think that legally, was one of the built-in assumptions that got the Constitution passed in the first place. That states weren't giving up their sovereign right to be independent and to regulate the way their people needed and whatnot. So I think that was an assumption in the Federalist Papers and in the arguments and whatever. 1787 or whatever they did the Constitution, but it seems like that's taken just the perverse twist when we got into slavery and the Civil War, is because then that became the argument is, well, states' rights is all important. That's more important than everything. And the only thing the states wanted to do was to enforce slavery. So, I mean, it wasn't like they were just wanting to uphold this right in the abstract, that this abstract right of states' rights is the end all and be all. They wanted it for a specific reason. And then it's just persisted to come up for whatever cause you have at the time.
Okay.
Do you have any advice on how to vote for judges? You know, you look at the blue book and yeah. you get some information. Where else can you go? Because it's impossible to know these judges, you know, that you vote on.
I have a comment on that. I think those things in the blue book are pretty good. Colorado has one of the best judicial nominating systems in the country. We have an independent judicial nominating boards that vet all the applicants, and they reduce it down to three non-political candidates for every judgeship. Those are submitted to the governor, and then the governor gets to pick from those three, and that's all. They can't go out to the pick their buddies or whatnot. And so it's a pretty fair system that does, it's non-political and it's merit-based.
Which the federal courts are not.
No.
But what we see on the ballot of, I forget what
you don't get
how we evaluate the ballot that we see for a continuation of judges.
Well, I always approve all of them, and unless there's a unless the judicial review has recommended that you not review them, or you know, and this group does a great job of that. Is if you see something and have credible information, like from the media or whatnot, that this judge has kind of apparent behavior. That doesn't happen very often. And usually the judicial review committee picks that up.
Mm-hmm.
It's happened a couple of times. We've had non-retention recommendations.
Some of them are eating dogs and cats, I hear. You never know.
We have pretty good jurists, I guess, in Colorado.
I want to give our Zoomers a chance to comment if they'd like to. Susan or Grant? No. Susan, is there a lot of Supreme Court issues in Canada where you are? You mind if I ask?
Our Supreme Court is very different. It doesn't have nearly the power, but it is a reputable body, and it is appointed, and the people there are not all jurists, if I recall, but the system is just different. There's just not the heavy weight placed on the Supreme Court that exists in the United States.
Interesting.
And your legislative body's working.
The legislative the Canadian Congress is doing its job. Yeah. Thank you, Susan.
And a consideration that is really concerning me is the fact that if you start looking at civilizations and the fall of civilization, it's almost always preceded by the rich becoming very powerful.
Mm-hmm.
And so that led to the fall of Rome, because all of a sudden the civilization was not represented by the people who lived in it.
Oh,
and so, when Citizens United decision came down, I told Judith, that's the end of our democracy. And look at what has happened with respect to money in the elections.
That's crazy.
It is very concerning.
What Citizens United did.
Pardon?
Do you want to tell them briefly what Citizens United did?
My preconceived notion of what I think about that is that it suspended the limits on political contributions for people in federal office, and then made it so that whoever was contributing did not have to, their name or organization did not have to be public knowledge. And that led to the establishment of these PACs which are completely opaque.
And corporations are now considered people, so they can donate.
For purposes of First Amendment rights and donations.
Yep.
But I have
it's a First Amendment based thing. And the notion that corporations are people is a long held thing. I mean, that's not new under Citizens United, but giving them the right and equating the right to donate money with free speech is kind of new.
I'm waiting for the first corporation to be put to death.
Yeah.
Well, as they say, we live in interesting times. So thank you, Ron and Linda and Jeff. Very nice. I think we should get college credit for today's class. The law. Thank you, everybody, for being here. Hope to see you next week. Bye.
Thank you. Bye.